library that's sitting here with me is one of the most, I'm getting a little bit pumped, but I'm making it. So I have to.
You just have to remember our name is back in City Hall. I mean, I've known Carla since I was a baby professional. So you should be nervous.
And what a professional you were, though, becomes Mr. Carla Public Library. I came back from Pittsburgh, and the library was part of your portfolio.
Yes, it was.
And it made such a difference to have somebody that understood libraries, that read and everything in government.
Library for us, like for all of you, you see, it's a part of any community, and that was the place for our family to go to get those early books, Dick and Jane books, Barbara the Elephant. You know, you go off into the children's corner where the colorful titles were. And then I thought one day I'd graduate to going upstairs where the books were darker and the jackets were maroon or blue, or that was where the serious books were upstairs.
Did you ever get to go?
Oh yeah. I got up there one day and I graduated. But that then the library became work, research papers, to Dewey Decimal System. It became a little sassy. Oh, only here.
So you continued, you went to school, you went to graduate school, all of that, and then your life got even busier. And how did you find time to read just for pleasure? And you know, we all want to know.
Say what?
Did you get a chance to read anything for pleasure?
Oh yeah, yeah. And there were moments of escape. Today, however, I'm spending most of my time selfishly focused on my book, so that's what I'm reading, y'all. And it's almost ready. It's coming. But I've been immersed in that process, so this year has been a little tougher for me because I'm trying to, you know, stay in my voice. But when I do have time, I have one of my chief of staff, Melissa, who, by the way, she's more excited to be here than she was to meet Bruce Springsteen. Melissa Winter is my book recommender. She loves you all, and I may lose her here in this convention. Believe me, she's been with me from the very beginning of the campaign, but she is my book guru, and I usually read what Melissa tells me I should read, so she'll pass on, she'll throw some books in my bag on a long trip. But what have I been reading? Like, I have a very eclectic sort of reading list. I've read Commonwealth. I love a good story that takes me outside of myself. I love everything that Zadie Smith has done. I actually accidentally reread that. I read it maybe 2 years ago, and then I was like, it was on my shelf, and I thought, I haven't read this. And I started reading it, and I was thinking, I must be have ESPN or something, because I know what's going to happen. This is how my life is, that I've these past decades, I forget what I've read, but I read it, and I realized by the third chapter that I read it already, but I finished it.
And I'm just going to say, did you put it down?
Oh, no. I love her storytelling, her characters. Finished reading Exit West, which was very good, very, very powerful. The Nightingale, I read this the other day. Any shout outs for The Nightingale? Chimamanda, Adichie, I love all of this stuff. So, I mean, you know, I love stories. I love to escape for a moment. I needed that escape over the past 10 years. I needed to get out of my own story, get into somebody else's story for a minute.
And were you able to do that?
Oh, yeah.
Get lost in a moment.
You know, I couldn't read in the White House at times. There was just too much going on. And we were running so fast that whenever I got a chance to sit down and pick up a book, I would get maybe a sentence and I would fall asleep. So I literally sitting down, I don't know if I was napping or passed out. I couldn't tell the difference. I'd wake up and it would be an hour and was I asleep? That's how the White House years felt. So usually on a longer trip, I could get into a book. But it was, you know, it was a hectic 8 years.
Now, you said pick up a book, so that implies the physical book.
Oh, I always
thought of e-books.
Yeah, I'm not an e-reader. I like to have a book in my hand. Even in my writing process, I like to hold it. I can't really edit things on the computer well. I feel like I have to write down my thoughts. I can jot down things on an iPhone, but that's hard. I have to feel it. I have to still be able to touch it.
I'm old, sorry. So we still have a lot of books in our house. And my husband, who, as you know, is an avid reader and still loves books around everywhere we've gone. He's just boxes and boxes of books that I can't get rid of. He will not allow me to do it. So we are still a household that is, we have books on shelves, lots of books on shelves.
Now, when I was a librarian, I did some research. And I understand that there's a library. You actually worked in a library bindery?
Oh, yes. I worked in a book bindery one summer. Bob Goldman's book bindery. I did. It was the summer right before I went to college. I had a friend's mother who worked there, and it was my first real job. Before then, I did the neighborhood jobs, babysitting. I had a family next to us that they paid me to do everything for them. Babysit, train their dog, tutor piano. The Smiths, I love them. They got me through high school. But then I graduated to a job downtown, the bindery was downtown, and a friend's mother worked there. My job entails doing one thing 1,000 times every day, all day, over and over again. So I got to put the little metal thing in a hole and then pass the cardboard over to the guy that would slam it down. So my job was to take the metal thing, put it in the hole, and pass it. And I was good with doing that for the first day. There would be an end to it, that there were like thousands of them, and I would prove to the bindery people that I was so fast and I could complete it and I would be done. And I just realized it's never over. They just kept coming. The little pieces of cardboard, the little things, and that went on for weeks and weeks and weeks doing the same thing. And I just thought, my God, I'm ready for college. But it taught me great respect for the men and women who do that work every day, that thankless work that makes it possible for us to have books and folders and, you know, I learned work ethic at the bindery. The dozens of people in that plant who came there and they did the same job every day for years and years and years. You know, they reminded me of my father, those blue-collar workers who didn't look for passion in their job. They didn't have the luxury like we did to think about doing the things that we love. They had to do things that put food on the table. And that was my first experience, shoulder to shoulder with men and women who were making a living for their families.
And you mentioned your father so many times about his work ethic and what it took for him to go to work and provide. You saw it first.
Oh, my father, Fraser Robinson, man. He was, you know, every value that I had in me came from my mother and father, watching them day to day. As most people know, my father was a blue-collar worker, worked the same job his entire life, worked at the water filtration plant. And my father had MS and contracted it at the prime of his life. So I never knew him to be able to walk without the assistance. But my father got up every day with a shift job. So, you know, some days he was on days, some days he was on nights, some days he was on evenings. So his schedule changed. And I remember him putting on his white t-shirt, his blue button-up uniform, and getting his crutches and making his way out the back door to the car to go to his job without complaint, without regret. Because he was proud that he had a job that allowed him to invest in his children, me and my brother. You know, with that blue-collar salary, he put two of us through college in Princeton at that. And to make sure that, you know, those were schools long before they had, the financial assistance that put you completely through. We were still paying. My parents had to pay a portion of our tuition. And he made sure that our tuition was paid on time. We never were going to be late and not be able to register for our classes. So who I am today is so much of it's because of my parents and that hard work ethic and, you know, the values of your word and your bond. You do what you say you're going to do. You know, trust is important. Honor, honesty. You know, I saw my father behave in that way every single day with everyone, regardless of race or station in life. So that's who I think about when I write my book and I how I carry myself in the world. I do what I think Marion and Frazier would expect me to do. I hope to be that person. Is your mom?
Oh, yes.
Hey, Mom.
So, and so whenever anything happens, she says, this is right. She's models after your mom.
Oh, yeah.
How your mom handled all of that. So she, your mom was right there with you.
Well, you know, Grandma, you know, we couldn't have made it through the White House without her. You know, just having her, she had been helping me long before coming to the White House because Barack was always, you know, he was a state senator in the U.S. Senate, and those were jobs that had him away from home, usually most of the week. And I still had a full-time job. I was, at any point in time, I was a professional with a big job of my own, and we had two little kids. And we had, you know, we could afford help. And we had a couple of great babysitters, but, you know, the time I lost that one good babysitter, and that crushed me like nothing else. I mean, when Globe, when she said she had to leave because she couldn't need to make more money, I thought I was losing an arm. You know, Barack was trying to console me, and I was like, dude, just get out of here. I need Globe. I don't need you. But I remember that pain, and I thought, how can I go to work every day and not know that my kids are good, that there was somebody who loves them, which is not to, you know, get on a soapbox, which is why affordable child care is so important, because for all the families out there who don't have a choice, they have to go to work. I know that pain of what it feels like when you don't know your kids are good. They're good not just being safe, but that they're in a place where somebody loves them and is going to instill values in them and is going to read to them and take them to the library and is not going to just plop them in front of the TV. So I was about to quit working and I thought, I just can't do it. I can't keep up the balance. And who stepped in but my mom, who was not yet retired, but she would come over at the crack of dawn to allow me to go to the gym. She'd start getting the kids ready for school. She'd wake them up, fix breakfast. I'd come back, I'd grab her. I'd take them to school, she'd go to work. She'd get off, she'd come and pick them up, get them home, start dinner. By that time I'd get home. I mean, we had our routine down. And there's just something about having your mom in that place where you know she will kill someone from the grandchildren. So she was the grandmother at the pickup line. She was going to be the first one at the pickup line because she didn't want her little grandbabies walking around wondering where their ride was. So she would get there an hour before pickup to be the first car so that she could see her babies and bring them here. You can't pay for that. So we brought that energy with us to the White House, and we needed that kind of no-nonsense, solid, tell-it-like-it-is, unimpressed with everything kind of personality that is Mary Robinson. You know, she did not want anybody doing her laundry at the White House. She could do her laundry just fine. She did with the notorious. We had housekeepers and butlers and everything at the White House. And she was like, don't touch my underwear. And she taught the girls to do their laundry. So they had laundry duty with grandma. Oh, yeah. Oh my God. She kept the whole White House grounded. Butlers, the staff, they'd just be in there chit-chat with her. She
the breeze, getting some wisdom, telling their stories. You know, she just had a whole psych counseling session up there in her suite of rooms. But she kept us humble and focused on what was important. And she was my sounding board. Anytime anything crazy happened over the course of the day, the first thing I would remind her of, suite of rooms were on the third floor above us. And I'd go there and I'd sit on her couch. She'd have on MSNBC or something, and she'd be trying not to talk about what was on the news until I kind of let her know that I was ready to talk about it. And she would do what she always did, sit there and just listen and go, And then what? My mother was not going to solve your problems for you.
No.
She was going to listen. And she would say, well, what do you think about that? And then you figure it out. By the time you leave, you figure out, how do you write? So much of my ability to get out there again and again and again had to do with going up to that little counseling room and sitting and having Mary Robinson go, you'll be fine. Just going back down there. Just can't stop now.
Did she ever tell you, you've talked about that a lot. What are you going to do?
Say that again.
Did she ever say, you've talked about that a lot. Now, what are you going to do about it?
No, my mother, and I write about this, about how my parents had a really advanced sense of parenting at a very early age. They taught us how to advocate for ourselves very early. So her expectation was like, you know how to fix your problems. You know what to do. And when you teach kids at an early age that they have a voice that's worth listening to, number one, and that their opinions actually matter, and that's what they get day in and day out in their home at the dinner table, two adults listening intently and asking questions and, you know, encouraging kids to contribute. That was the household. Those were our dinner tables. So that when you came home from school with a problem, you could hear it, but you had to go back and solve it. And so at 40, 50 years old, no, my mother wasn't assuming at all that she needed to solve any problems that I had at first. Like, her expectations were, you will do this, and you will do this well because you know how to do this. So there was never any need for her to even pretend like she had to give me direction. She knew she had instilled those values in me when I was 4 and 5 and 7. So she had done the work.
What a blessing. And you mentioned too, you almost thought about quitting because you did have, and I don't know how many people realize what high power positions you had as a career woman. Like, to balance that.
Well, before I was first lady?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I had jobs before I was first lady, everyone. Sometimes I had lost.
Executive vice president.
I had big jobs. I was really, I was smart, was, continued to be. Carla, working on libraries, worked in planning and economic development, ran a nonprofit organization, was vice president of hospital. I don't know. I just, maybe it was
osmosis.
So yeah, you know, I didn't come to the position of first lady a blank slate. And that's sort of what happens in society with spouse. You become a spouse all of a sudden. You know, and I felt, and I talk about this in the book, of how I felt myself becoming a spouse. I went from being an executive to becoming a spouse, where the first thing people would talk about was, what shoes is she wearing? And it's like, oh, no, people. Not, you're not focusing on my shoes, right? I mean, I'm standing in front of, like, military families. We're doing important things, but... So yes, there were moments in my profession because the burden of child rearing fell on me as a woman. You know, there was part of my trajectory as my husband's ascent got faster and higher and louder. There was the challenge of how do I make sure that my kids are sane and I have a career. But yeah, that started very early, those doubts, those questions of how do you balance it all? And is it fair that we're on his rocket ship ride when I have one too? But that's something that I write about. That's what you learn, the balance of marriage. That, and I tell young people this all the time, particularly young women, is that what I've learned is that you can have it all, but you usually can't have it all at the same time. And that's a myth, that even having the expectation of having it all is a setup for young people, young couples, young men and women with children, the notion that you're not successful if you don't have it all. Well, it's hard to balance it all. But I started to learn that life is long, and there are trade-offs that you make. And I think that the trade-off of stepping off of my path, until at least I found a child care solution that worked for me, which was my mom, I entertained the notion of stepping off of my track because I felt like I have these two kids and I brought them here. So my first priority is to make sure that they are okay. I can't save the world if my household isn't solid. But the other thing I learned at that point in time when I was ready to jump off professional track, I started not caring what people thought about me professionally. So I felt more freedom to ask for what I needed. So I wound up staying in my career because I had an opportunity to become the vice president of community affairs at the University of Chicago. The president was looking for a new person to head that division, and I had just had Sasha. She was 4 months old, and I was like, not doing it, don't care about work. But one of my good friends said, well, you should interview because this guy is really different. And I was like, okay, I don't care. So I was still breastfeeding, so I had Sasha in the crib and said, we're going to an interview, baby.
Those are the kind of things that I'm exploring in the book as well.